Hello viewers, today let us examine Mary Wollstonecraft's Vindication of Rights of Women. In many ways, Mary Wollstonecraft's essay, The Vindication of Rights of Women, can be said to have ushered in the discourse of feminism. Published in the year 1792, the essay was published right after Mary's earlier essay, Vindication of Rights of Men. Mary was writing the Vindication of Rights of Men in response to Edmund Burke. In the essay, Mary argued that women were equal to men in all respects. The lack of education and the societal structure inhibited women from competing with men. Mary Wollstonecraft, England-born English writer, was born on 27th April 1759 in London. She died on the 30th of August 1797 in London. She was one of the first English women to have written explicitly about political affairs. Born into a family of sufficient means, Mary suffered as the abusive father squandered away the family's wealth. The family had to often move from place to place to escape from creditors. Mary was largely educated at home, and she relied on her innumerable friendships to further her own intellectual growth. Mary was a girl who braved her father and often rescued her mother and sisters from his beatings. Mary Wollstonecraft was mostly self-taught, and her personality made it possible for her to cultivate friendship with leading scholars of her time. Two women, Jane Arden and Fanny Blood, were influential in acquainting Mary with the world of books and ideas. Along with Fanny Blood, Mary established a school for girls. The poor health and subsequent demise of Blood led to the closure of the school. For a few years, Mary worked as a governess. In 1785, Mary left her position and was disappointed at the lack of decent employment opportunities for educated but poor women. It was then that she decided to become a writer. She moved to London and learned German and French. In 1787, Mary began to translate works of contemporary German and French authors into English. Joseph Johnson, who was then the editor of the Analytical Review, offered a work, and she reviewed novels for the journal. It was through Johnson that Mary met Thomas Paine and William Goodwin. Mary also pursued two tumultuous relationships which affected her deeply. The first one that Mary pursued was with the already married artist Henry Fuseli. The affair occurred during Mary's stay in London. The second relationship was with Gilbert Imlay and happened during her stay in Paris. Post the French Revolution, Mary moved to Paris along with many other English liberal thinkers. By then, Mary had published her first truly popular work, Vindication of Rights of Men. She was already a friend of Paine and Godwin and was an integral part of the liberal intellectual circle in Paris. The Rights of Men was written in response to the conservative philosopher Edmund Burke's critique, Reflection on the Revolution in France, which was published in 1790. The work made her a celebrity overnight and was immediately listed alongside liberal thinkers such as Joseph Priestley and Thomas Paine. Thomas Paine was inspired by Mary and published his celebrated Rights of Man in 1791. In 1792, Mary published what is today considered her finest piece, The Vindications of Rights of Women. In Paris, Mary met Imlay and they began a passionate relationship. Imlay and Mary were difficult partners. They begot a girl child who Mary christened Fanny Imlay in honor of her deceased friend, Fanny Blood. Mary attempted suicide twice. Mary followed Imlay to England and also traveled to Scandinavian countries. In 1796, as Mary returned to England, she returned to Johnson's circle once again. Godwin and Mary found each other and embarked on a passionate affair. They married in 1797, and the marriage came under severe criticism. Godwin was an anarchist who had earlier strongly opposed marriage as a social institution. Mary died in 1798, 10 days after she gave birth to a second child, who was also named Mary. The child would grow up to be the novelist Mary Shelley. Post her death, Godwin wrote a biography of Mary, which was titled Memoirs. Godwin's work was authentic, but the public was scandalized as they read about Mary's earlier affairs. Mary was typecasted as a woman of loose morals. Her reputation came in the way as readers often judged her works based on her life. It was only towards the end of the 19th century that Mary was reinstated in her rightful place alongside her brilliant contemporaries. Today, Mary is regarded as one of the initiators of the discourse of feminism. Mary Wollstonecraft had a difficult childhood. Her formal education was quite short. She was self-taught and was fiercely independent. She witnessed domestic abuse at home. She was aware that the plight of poor women who were academically good was despicable. Her experiences taught her to question the politics of gender in society. In many ways, her troubled background forced her to travel often and exposed her to diverse experiences and made her a fiercely independent personality. Mary had a diverse set of friends. All these influences affected the nature of her work. Given her background, it was natural that Mary chose to write on the subjects of education and rights. The majority of Wollstonecraft's early work, written before 1789, discussed education. Johnson employed her to assemble an anthology to aid the improvement of young women. Mary titled it The Female Reader. Later, she translated two children's works from German into English. One of them became famous as The Elements of Morality. Mary was working on a book of her own at least from 1780. It was published as Thoughts on the Education of Daughters and was published in 1787. The book acted as a conduct book for the society. Wollstonecraft also published a collection of short stories for children, which she titled Original Stories from Real Life, and it was brought out in 1788. In these books, Mary Wollstonecraft urged that children should be educated in the ethos of the emerging middle class. She argued that self-discipline, honesty, frugality, and social contentment should be inculcated in children from an early age through education. She was influenced by the philosophy of John Locke and stated a rational outlook should be promoted among children. The contemporary reader must keep in mind that in the 18th century, literary rebels in England were despicable and a large section of population was out of school. The education of girls and women was a controversial topic. In 1790, Mary was incensed by the conservative commentary that Burke offered on the French Revolution. She responded to Burke with the Vindication of Rights of Men in 1790. The work brought Mary instant respect and influenced the publication of Thomas Paine's Rights of Man. Mary, who was passionate about the cause of women, wrote The Vindication of Rights of Women in 1792. The work was very progressive, as Mary discussed the twin issues which were dear for her all through her life: education of women and the universal rights of human beings. In 1795, Mary traveled to Scandinavian countries. She kept a diary, which was published as Letters Written in Sweden, Norway, and Denmark. The work was published in 1796. The book was well received and won Mary the admiration of Godwin. Mary could paint the beauty of nature with words, and the travel guide influenced the writing style of Romantics. Samuel Coleridge and Wordsworth were influenced by the travelogue. Wollstonecraft also wrote two novels. The first novel, Mary, a Fiction, was published in 1788, and it closely mirrored the life of Wollstonecraft's own sister. The second novel, Maria, or The Wrongs of Woman, was published posthumously in 1798. In both the novels, the protagonists are women who are forced into loveless marriages. Mary's work, in short, was influenced by the philosophy of Locke and Jean-Jacques Rousseau. On reading the text of Mary Wollstonecraft's The Vindication of Rights of Men, her editor and patron, Mr. Johnson, said that it seems that in the act of writing the later portions of Rights of Men, Mary discovered the subject that would preoccupy her for the rest of her career. The subject that preoccupied Mary Wollstonecraft the most was the status of women. In many ways, Mary was a feminist much before she published her celebrated essay. Mary's Vindication of Rights of Women was a logical sequel to the immensely popular Vindication of Rights of Men. By 1790, Mary was identified as a powerful intellectual in European liberal circles. She had by then drafted essays on women's education, careers for educated women from poor families, and two novels whose protagonists were women. She traveled widely and was in touch with leading philosophers of her day. Mary Wollstonecraft was already familiar with the works of leading philosophers of European Enlightenment. Mary Wollstonecraft, like most of the liberal thinkers of her generation, was very happy with the French Revolution. She genuinely hoped that the revolution would usher in great change across the world. Mary was incensed when the traditionalists attacked the spirit of revolution. The affront led her to draft the Vindication of Rights of Men. In the essay, Mary Wollstonecraft adopted a feminist tone as she attacked the sexist language of Edmund Burke. Her subsequent work, particularly the Vindication of Rights of Women, even while dealing with the issues of rights of women, focused on the need for providing education to girls. Building on the ideas proposed by various philosophers, including Rousseau, Wollstonecraft argued that equality was possible in society only when women were granted equal rights. Education was the only means through which a just society was to be built. A Vindication of Rights of Men was published as response to Burke's Reflections on the Revolution in France. Burke, who was by then one of the leading intellectuals of the 18th century, was a conservative philosopher who was a supporter of constitutional monarchy, aristocracy, and the church. Burke, through a study of revolution, lamented the lack of chivalry amongst the masses and advocated the need to return to traditional modes of living. Incensed by Burke's regressive rhetoric, Wollstonecraft drafted a Vindication of Rights of Men. She advocated republicanism instead of aristocracy. The text became a part of the revolutionary controversy. Besides attacking Burke's ideas, Wollstonecraft also attacked the language that Burke used in the text. Wollstonecraft was one of the first women to have analyzed the language of a text and questioned the gendered language that Burke used. Mary questioned the usage of the terms sublime and beautiful and undermined the rhetoric and the arguments that Burke used. In one of his earlier celebrated works, published in 1756, Burke associated beautiful with weakness and femininity. he placed the sublime alongside strength and masculinity. In a cleverly worded argument, Wollstonecraft turned his definitions against Burke and argued that Burke rendered the women weak. Burke, Wollstonecraft argued, tried to make women out of citizens. In other words, she blamed Burke for swaying citizens with his words. Wollstonecraft accused Burke for creating an unequal society where women were the passive subjects. Wollstonecraft urged that the Republican virtue, which is based on the ethos of the emerging middle class, was the best alternative for the vice-ridden codes of manners. She was undoubtedly influenced by the Enlightenment and believed in progress. She opines that relying on tradition and custom led to continuation of slavery. She argues for rationality and derides Burke for his belief in ancestral traditions. Wollstonecraft constructs a utopian society where each family possesses a farm. The Rights of Men was Wollstonecraft's first overtly political work as well as her first feminist work. It was this text that made her a well-known writer. And as you all know, it was soon followed by Thomas Paine's The Rights of Man. The text was in many ways the precursor to the philosophical texts that discussed political rights in the 19th century. Mary Wollstonecraft's essay, A Vindication of Rights of Women, is one of the earliest works of feminist philosophy. Wollstonecraft's basic claim is that women ought to be better educated. Education gives women a position in society. Such an investment will lead to the creation of a better nation, as women will educate their children. Educated women will act as companions and partners to their husbands, instead of surviving just as their wives. Instead of viewing women as ornaments or property which are exchanged through marriage, Mary argues that women, because they are human beings, deserve the same fundamental rights as men. A significant portion of Mary Wollstonecraft's text is dedicated to replying to the concerns of philosophers such as James Fordyce, John Gregory, and Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Even Rousseau, who was the most liberal and radical of the 18th century thinkers, deemed that women should only be educated as to please men. Wollstonecraft states that many women are undoubtedly as silly and superficial as spaniels and toys. However, she points out that women are silly not because of any innate deficiency of mind. They are weak because men have denied them access to schools and education. Wollstonecraft illustrates the limitations that women's deficient education have placed on them. She states that, taught from their infancy that beauty is women's scepter, the mind shapes itself to the body and, roaming round its guilt cage, only seeks to adorn its prison. The society, Mary argues, deems women as mere wives, as appendages which are required for the running of the family. She argues there is a focus on education. Women will stop worrying about their bodies and instead will emerge as serious human beings. While Wollstonecraft argues for equality between sexes, she does not explicitly state that men and women are equal. She resorts to the Bible and states that men and women are equal in the eyes of God. Wollstonecraft famously and ambiguously writes, "Let it not be concluded that I wish to invert the order of things. I have already granted that from the constitution of their bodies, men seem to be designed by Providence to attain a greater degree of virtue. I speak collectively of the whole sex, but I see not the shadow of a reason to conclude that their virtues should differ in respect to their nature. In fact, how can they, if virtue has only one eternal standard? I must therefore, if I reason consequentially, as strenuously maintain that they have the same simple direction as that there is a God. However, Wollstonecraft attacks society's intent to lock women into demeaning roles. She is particularly severe on false and excessive sensibility that many women resort to. She states that women who succumb to sensibility tend to be blown about by every momentary gust of feeling. Such women are a prey of their senses and thus are incapable of thinking rationally. Such women, Wollstonecraft claims, harm the entire civilization. She states that the society requires women who can refine a civilization, but the current crop of women, she argues, are destroying it. While Wollstonecraft does not state that reason and feeling should be independent of each other, she believes that reason and feeling should inform each other. Besides her philosophical moorings, the tract also includes Wollstonecraft's educational plans for women. Throughout the 12th chapter, titled On National Education, Wollstonecraft spells out her plans to send children to a country day school. She states that children should also be educated at home. Wollstonecraft argues that school should focus on co-education. She reasons that since marriages are the cement of society, she calls it the cement of society, men and women should be educated after the same model. Wollstonecraft is mainly writing for the middle class women. For Mary, middle class is the most natural class, and her address in many ways is the bourgeois view of the world. While Mary Wollstonecraft is viewed as the precursor to women's writings, her ambiguous statements regarding the equality of sexes have made it difficult to classify her as a modern feminist. However, she was one of the first women to have written explicitly on the political rights of women. Secondly, through her writings, she encouraged modesty and industry in the reader and attacks the uselessness of aristocracy. Wollstonecraft's view of the world is not necessarily friendly to the poor. It is a middle-class eyes view of the world. In other words, it was a bourgeois view of the world. For instance, in A National Plan for Education, Mary Wollstonecraft argues that after the age of 9 years, the poor students, except for those who are brilliant in studies, should be separated from the rich and should be taught in another school. Instances like these in her writings make it difficult to classify Mary as a feminist writer or as a progressive writer. However, the contemporary reader must understand that Mary Wollstonecraft wrote her work over 200 years ago. Today, she is placed alongside her illustrious contemporaries like Paine, Goodwin, and Burke, and is identified as one of the leading intellectuals of the 18th century. She is also placed alongside Rousseau as an educationist. Mary's writings influenced the thinking of romantics such as Wordsworth and Coleridge. Dear learners, I hope you enjoyed the lesson on Mary Wollstonecraft's life and work. I hope you'll be inspired to read more about Mary Wollstonecraft's work in future. It was nice meeting you. Thank you.